Get ready.
Hashtag Team Fibro.
Reloaded.
Everybody, Crystal here at the Fibromyalgia Pain Chronicles and veteran voices for fibromyalgia, teaming up with Justin Birckbichler, the founder of A Ballsy Sense of Tumor. And in this discussion today, we're going to discuss men's health, preventative care, and overall well-being for our male warriors out there. Justin, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to, you know, do this, have this discussion today. It's so imperative and important because we want to support our male counterparts in making sure they have access to healthcare, but doing so in a preventative, early manner. So I find your journey very interesting. And for everyone who's watching this, Justin and I actually met in 2018 at the Weagle Health Awards. Justin is hilarious. And being able to meet him and have some discussions where I kind of put him under the fire. If you all know me, I start wrapping off those questions just to kind of, you know, get to know people. And I've followed his journey ever since. And what you're doing is phenomenal. And you've really, really have been, you know, a real integral, basically team member in the men's health space, promoting awareness and engagement, especially during the month of November. So Justin, I'm going to turn it over to you so you could share your personal story and how you parlayed that into testicular cancer advocacy, men's health, and mental health awareness.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll just start by saying you're going to see a lot of animals throughout the course of this interview, because so far, two of the three have popped up. So we'll find out. So yeah, well, first and foremost, Crystal, thank you for having me. Always a pleasure to speak with you. You know, I remember meeting in Boston, and, you know, you weren't wrong, put me right under the gun. But it's, you know, we've been friends ever since. So you didn't put me too far under the gun. So yeah, I was diagnosed with testicular cancer about 6 years ago, almost to the day. This is early November that we're doing this. It was late October is when I was diagnosed in 2016. I was 25 years old at the time, pretty much completely healthy. I had done a Spartan run in late August or early September. Really had no other signs or symptoms. Really, the only thing that led me to realize that something was wrong was I was doing my monthly self-exam in the shower, and I noticed on my left testicle there was really two areas that concerned me. One was kind of felt about the size of a frozen pea towards the bottom of the testicle. It was a hard lump. Just, you know, frozen pea is the best way I can describe it. And then there was also an area that kind of felt similar to like the outline of like a jellyfish, as if it were to like be wrapped around a rock. And neither of those areas had been there in September when I had done my self-exam. Testicular self-exam was one of the few things that I actually did that was that my doctors had recommended just by the grace of God. My pediatrician, as soon as I became a teenager, started telling me about those, and the primary care doctor I saw in my early 20s also mentioned it. So, you know, there was something at work there reinforcing the need to do that. So I did the self-exam in early October, and then I had to find a doctor. And I say I had to find a doctor because at the time I didn't have a doctor. The last time I had been to the doctor was like 2012, 2013. Really, you know, I was the prototypical, I'm early 20s, I'm healthy, I'm fit, I'm fine. I don't need to go to the doctor. It's just a waste of time. Now I go to the doctor constantly. But I had to locate a doctor. And I remember when I first made that call, I didn't even really want to admit what the problem was. I just said, hey, I need to get in for a checkup. And they're like, well, the earliest we have for a checkup is December. So this was early October. I was like, I don't think this can wait 2 months. So I said, I felt a lump on my testicle. And then, you know, they were able to get me in a little sooner. From there, the doctor did a exam and said, yeah, there's an area of concern here. Let's go get you an ultrasound. They did an ultrasound. I like to call them a bultrasound because that just works. And, you know, getting a testicular ultrasound is just as awkward and just as weird feeling as it sounds. Furthermore, I did it on my lunch break at work. So I didn't really think that through, that I was leaving to go get an ultrasound of my testicles and I had to go and work for the rest of the day with like the, and there's cat number two.
All three friends are welcome.
Yeah. And we'll see if the dog gets up at any point. But yeah, so I had to go back to work with, you know, the ultrasound gel all up in my nether regions. That was a fun day to say the least.
But it wasn't a ball-tastic kind of day.
It was. I certainly did not have a ball with that.
Real quick, just to interject, Justin uses humor a lot with his advocacy. So I was just trying to play on that a little bit.
Yeah. You should. My ultimate goal is one day for there just to be like a running tally of ball jokes, like as I'm saying them, you know, like dings and it says like 12, 13. But I digress. So I got that ultrasound done and they found that there was indeed a mass on the on my testicle that needed to be taken care of. So I was then referred to a urologist. So I had gone, you know, for years not seeing a doctor, to in the span of a week, I saw a doctor, a radiologist, and then a urologist. So he said, yeah, you know, the ultrasound shows that there is something, it's most likely cancer. We're going to have to remove the testicle. I was like, hold up here, sir. I just met you. You're not taking my testicle. And he explained that really when they suspect testicular cancer, they can't do a biopsy just because of the anatomy of the scrotum and everything. They have to take the whole testicle out. So that was the first time that I had really a hard time with it. I didn't want to have my testicle. At the time I was very wrapped up in my head that having only one testicle would make me less of a man. So I told the doctor I couldn't agree to surgery that day. Even though he's like, okay, I understand. But this could literally be a matter of life and death. So I went home and I thought on it and I decided to go through with the surgery because, again, matter of life and death, quite literally. They did the surgery, they biopsied it. The tumor had taken over the vast majority of the testicle. I don't remember the exact dimensions off the top of my head, but I think my testicle was more tumor than testicle by that point. So they also did full body scans, found that it had spread to my lymph nodes and told me I was going to need chemo, to get rid of, you know, it wasn't just contained in the testicle, even though I had caught it relatively early, it had still spread. So when they told me I needed chemo, what I wanted was I went online to see what it was going to be like being, you know, a cancer patient, a male cancer patient in his early 20s. What am I going to expect? And I could find a lot of medical jargon, but I couldn't really find like a patient-friendly resource. So I had kind of been journaling what I was going through as a way to cope with all the life-changing news that I was getting. And I was talking to one of my friends about it and saying, you know, there's not this resource. And she said, then why don't you create the resource? So that's what eventually turned into my website, A Ballsy Sense of Tumor, where I documented everything from, you know, finding that initial lump up until, you know, the entire surgery, recovery, chemo, so on and so forth. You know, the ups and the downs of the physical and the mental health, really everything that's happened in my life has been documented more or less on the website for the past 6 years. So while, you know, I was getting ready for chemo, I was getting the website built up. I spent more time coming up with a name than like making the decision to actually start the website. I was very proud of the name and still am to this day. And so I wrote, I was writing my story. And what I learned as I was writing up the story is I didn't want it to just be the story of Justin. I wanted it to be, you know, applicable to any guy who was going through it. So I was looking it up and I found the reticence to call a doctor or not even having a doctor, and not wanting to admit that there was a problem wasn't something isolated to me. It's, you know, we're in the midst of a pandemic, but that's been men not taking care of their health has been pandemic for much, much longer. So I realized that it was, you know, it was a mission that was very personal to me, but it's personal to everybody, whether or not you're a male. Everybody has someone who's a male in their life, and it's important to be taking care of it. So I also found that, you know, guys don't want to lecture about their health, which is why I decided to go through humor, because if you're just going to like beat a guy down with, take care of your health, do this, they're not going to be receptive. Really, they're just going to get downright testy, as I like to say. And so, you know, approaching it from humor makes things, helps the medicine go down a little bit better. And so I've been able to just kind of use humor and just use my experience. So I went through, chemo for 3 months, was put into remission status in March of 2017, remain in that status. So coming up on this, you know, spring will be 6 years since I was put in remission. And I found that since then, you know, still being a men's health advocate has been a big vital part of my own healing and journey and everything. But I've also found that living in the aftermath of cancer, with all the mental health ramifications that come from that, has been another thing that I never expected. And that's something I don't approach with as much humor, because, you know, when I'm talking about mental health, I'll joke about it, but it is something that needs a little bit more seriousness and a little bit more tact. And so that's been a whole, you know, when I started this journey 6 years ago, I wasn't expecting the mental health thing to be just so, you know, such a big part of what I have been doing. But I've also found that, you know, if men were bad at taking care of their physical health, taking care of their mental health is even worse. So really just encouraging guys to take care of all parts of their health, has been a really big passion of mine. And, you know, that kind of puts my story into a nutshell, if you will.
All those puns. So in a sense, your health journey was, some of it was like the epitome of the stigmas, surrounding, accessing and preventative care for men, but also some barriers too, because of how, you know, societal thinking about men and who they are as a person and a character, and then the self-efficacy to, you know, kind of gets hit a little bit, because it's one thing to have cancer, right? But as you said, you know, this is a very, you know, sensitive area for men, where all the fear, anxiety, questioning, even kind of redefining yourself a little bit in this new space you're in. So, you know, by sharing these steps, it's helping men understand, like, hey, I've been there, and, you know, I didn't have a doctor. I was young and just kind of was like, huh, that don't seem right. Let me go get that checked out, to all of a sudden you're being diagnosed with cancer. And I'd imagine, you know, I do hear this a lot across, you know, a variety of cancers, but also chronic illnesses, invisible illnesses, that depression, anxiety is a very, very common, I'll call secondary symptoms or situational symptoms. While depression, anxiety are their own medical conditions, you know, I often will have this kind of, you know, thought process in my head that, hey, if I wasn't diagnosed with this illness, then it's probably more likely, you know, less likely than not, I wouldn't have had to experience depression, anxiety. And then I know I worked in mental health for many years as well, and have a lot of veteran male friends and also collaborating with male advocates that, you know, having that discussion of the mental health piece has been in a sense, like very difficult to just have this open forum where in general men feel safe to have this discussion, but also actively listen and digest everything in their own time. And, you know, when I was looking up some stats for suicide stats, and I knew the statistics were pretty high, but I, you know, pulling some numbers for men's health, and the increased risk for suicide among men when they are diagnosed with a serious illness, and then it's compounded with the aftermath of all the mental health and processing and dealing with it, it becomes an existential, like, silent crisis amongst men, contributing to the high suicide rates. And I'm just bringing this up, you know, I don't want to trigger anybody or upset anybody, but I feel that, you know, this is in a very alarming rate, especially when I would read these stories of men who, you know, battled through cancer, but then had such a difficult time battling the mental health aspect of it. And I don't, in general, I don't think mental health is discussed enough. I'm a Gen Xer, so we are kind of like, suck it up and drive on, like, we're all fine. You know, I did all this and made it through all this and I turned out okay, you know, and that's a huge pervasive stigma in our society that has been carrying over in younger generations. And then I see that mentality kind of infiltrating the medical spaces and healthcare. So from your perspective, but also what you've heard within your communities, is other than some of the stuff that we've both brought up, what are some other like stigmas or stereotypes that you feel impacts a man's decision whether or not to seek healthcare or mental health support?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing, the single biggest stigma or barrier, I would say, is that we have the kind of the idea that men need to be the provider or the protector of the family. And when you're going through something, whether it's, again, mental health, physical health, and you are down, you feel like you can't be the provider and the protector of the family. Because I know when I was going through chemo, I spent the vast majority of the time in a chemo chair or in bed or sleeping or throwing up or just feeling like crap. I was not in any position to provide or protect for anybody. But my counterpoint to that is, if you are not taking care of your health, you won't be around to be there to take care of others. And that's, you know, that's putting it very bluntly, but, you know, had I not been doing a self-examine, had I not gone to a doctor, you know, even though I caught it relatively early on, it had spread. If I felt something, or if I wasn't doing self-exam, there is a likelihood that I would not be here today. And that goes for anything, whether, again, if you are noticing a mental health change and, you know, it gets to that point. And I've been there before where I've contemplated suicide and I talked myself out of it, but I didn't stop there. I got help. I saw a therapist. I got on meds. I did a bunch of things. I didn't just try to grin and bear it myself, because, you know, you can't do it. And you're not weak for talking to somebody about your physical and mental health. I'd argue that it's stronger to admit that there is something wrong and that you need help for it. Again, whether it's mental or physical. And I think that's how we eventually change the stigma, is making it normalized that guys talk about their health and they take care of their health and they take a proactive approach and they talk about it openly. I mean, I used to work in elementary education, and that's a field, you know, very dominated by women. I mean, the education field in general, but especially elementary. And women would talk about getting a mammogram or a pap smear or whatever in just everyday conversation. But, you know, people, the few guys that I talked with, we didn't talk about doing testicular self-exams or going to get a prostate exam or a colonoscopy or something like that. And why weren't we? Now I make it a point to have those conversations because, you know, to get a large change, it starts at a personal level. And the more conversations we have with, you know, just your friends, it will ripple out from there.
So from your experience, Do you feel like the dynamics changed after your diagnosis with your friends who were men? Do you think that if there was a change, was it for the better? Or do you feel like they were kind of like at first, like, you know, because this is such a sensitive topic that I feel that some, you know, some men would internalize your experience and just be like, ooh, you know, like, so did you see any changes in those dynamics where some men you knew wanted to learn and some were kind of like, I don't know how to process this myself. So how are you doing? You know, and I don't know if I can have that conversation with you right now because you're the one that's going through this, but I feel guilty because I'm kind of like, whoa, you know, like maybe I should find a PCP or, you know, does it kind of make
sense? So, I mean, I would say by and large, most of my male friends have taken more proactive approach to their health. I know a couple months after my diagnosis, I was visiting one of my friends and he said that he had started doing self-exams because of what had happened to me. And he felt something was amiss and he ended up going to a doctor and, you know, luckily it wasn't cancer. It was, I don't remember what it ended up being, but it was more or less a non-issue. But you know, you never know. You can't tell by when you feel something, if that is it cancer, is it something else? And, you know, he was able to get not a biopsy, like some sort of scan done and found out that it was nothing. Would he have done that if I had not been diagnosed and I had not shared? Probably not. So, you know, it's by and large, everybody has somebody, whether in their immediate family or their immediate friend circle, who's been diagnosed with cancer or had a close experience with cancer. And so I think there are the two mindsets you kind of mentioned there, like I'm going to kind of put my head in the sand and pretend it can never happen to me, or I'm going to do what I can to be proactive. And I think it's around the narrative of what we do with our information and our experience. You know, it's, I rather, if, you know, I'm still here today to be able to talk about it. And I largely credit that I'm here because I caught it early. And, you know, I have known guys who have passed away from testicular cancer or other types of cancer, and it's not necessarily their own fault. It was just caught too late. And, you know, they did what they could treatment wise, but it just wasn't enough. And so I think where we want to get is where guys are talking about their health and taking care of their health and going to the doctor, doing, you know, routine self-exams. And, you know, you can't know what your baseline is and what's abnormal if you don't get to know what your normal is. And so, you know, for any of the guys listening or any of the, what another thing that I hear is any of the women who have men in their lives, you know, encourage the men in your lives to, if they haven't done a testicular self-exam or they haven't been to the doctor, make a point to get that done today. Oh, you're not going to get into the doctor today, but make a call to get into a doctor. You know, it's most of, I think actually everyone's like required to have health insurance. I don't really know how that works, but in America, you know, you're paying the premiums and preventative care treatments in most insurance plans are, you know, you have a copay and that might be it. Don't quote me. I'm not an insurance specialist, but
it all comes down to the type of insurance and plan, and it can vary from state to state. So that's a very complex topic, but yeah. The bottom line is for preventative care, annual checkups, it's usually little to no cost. And then if you don't have insurance or if you're underinsured, there's a lot of subsidized health clinics, you know, throughout the U.S. And I'm not saying that they're always accessible because they don't necessarily will have them in rural areas, but there's more ways now to access healthcare in order to engage in preventative or oversight medical care, as I'd like to call it. And, you know, the other thing is too, like as a veteran, unrelated, but sort of related is, you know, the VA, unless if you are service connected for something related to like your jaw or your teeth or you're 100%, they don't offer dental care, not even basic cleanings. And I do have insurance, my own insurance, but, you know, dental care is something that they consider it medical care, but we're not really you know, pushing that advocacy envelope to say, hey, we need to do better because there's so many things related dental wise that can lead to other things. So, you know, as a veteran, you know, last year I chipped a tooth and I just happened to know some dental offices that provide free, you know, dental care for veterans. And I said, I couldn't get into my dentist. So I said, okay. And not only was able to get it done, but I wasn't charged. And so a lot of times it's a matter of researching where we can access affordable health care if we're underinsured or if our copays are expensive or deductibles. You know, it, what, one of the things is you know, you brought up, you know, women or significant others of men who are, you know, hesitant or not actively engaging in annual wellness checkups and preventative care. And I know that, okay, I'll start listening. Okay, I'm a female, obviously, and I'm an Army veteran. So I'm pretty straightforward. When I have something to say, and Justin could tell you, is if I'm going to have something to say, it doesn't mean I say it in like a undiplomatic way, but I'm one of those people, just say what I feel needs to be said. And I feel like when it comes to men's health, just in general, but obviously with testicular cancer and mental illness, I am very cognizant that how I were to advocate or speak to a man on this topic, I might have to adapt to each person or make sure that it's coming across in a supportive way versus like an assertive kind of drill sergeant way. Like, you know, I've been married before and I used to kind of harp on my ex-husband, like, you need to go to the doctor and blah, blah, blah. So how are some ways that significant others of men who we want to encourage to engage in their health and wellness and preventive care and early, you know, prevention, you know, actions, how can we cultivate that discussion with that male in our life where it's supportive, but without it, you know, coming across like, hey, you need to get this done? Or, you know, what do you think would be some great ways or phrases even or statements to open up that discussion so that no one feels like they're kind of being taken aback?
Yeah. And I think the bottom line is you want to encourage them to go to the doctor because you care about them. It's not something, you know, it's not like doing laundry or doing dishes, you know, it's because it's something annoying. You want them to take care of them, their health and their lives so they can be around for you longer. And I think framing it that way and, you know, not making it a, you know, a demanding, you need to go to the doctor, but hey, I would like for you to go to the doctor because I want you around as long as possible. You know, using a lot of I statements and saying, you know, I know sometimes it can be inconvenient, but I know it can be something that can help too. And there's a lot of different ways now, especially, you know, a lot. One of the best things I think that came out of the pandemic was how it really forced telehealth to take off. And there are certain things that you can do telehealth. There are certain things that you need to go into a doctor's office for. But I think framing it as you care about that man and you want that man to have the best possible life, both for himself and for the person that the people that he cares for and provides for, is the best way, rather than doing it as something that it's just, you know, a nag for the sake of doing it. You know, if it goes back to what I was saying earlier, that if you're not taking care of yourself, you may not be here to take care of others.
The other, you know, question I'd like to ask you, and this is, you know, it's just to kind of have this pick our brains type of discussion, but, you know, as a whole culturally, medical health and mental health was kind of seen as this self-indulgent thing. Like we, older generations, and I know, my family, you know, my great-grandmother was alive for a bit while after I was born, and my great-grandmother, my mom. And so I've seen a lot of these generational ideals kind of permeating in younger generations, and that you went to the doctor when something was wrong. And so really for the past, I would say 25 years, we're trying to, you know, shift that paradigms who say, no, we go so we don't have to have this reactionary healthcare response. And I know that the other thing that comes with chronic illness, cancer, it really changes your life. And we're seeing now and talking more about the emotional aftermath. So I kind of would like to just for a few minutes, maybe brainstorm, have a discussion. How can we start incorporating the importance of why you're dealing with this medical, physical health condition, the aftermath when things, come full circle is you might have to process some things. So how can we encourage engaging in even an emotional support group or mental health services, a men's support group? How can we start having that conversation earlier in this process so that we see more men engaging in healthcare before there's a mental health crisis, as kind of what I call the emotional fallout after going through such a, serious physical medical condition?
Yeah. And I think it's a couple different approaches. I think from the start, as soon as somebody says that, or as soon as they are diagnosed with a specific illness, that's a great time to, get the ball rolling, if you will, on mental health services. Because, and, my oncology office was great at that. I was resistant to do anything about it for quite some time. But letting them know that, hey, you are going to go through some mental health challenges. I don't care who you are. If you, once you're diagnosed with a chronic illness of any sort, you are going to go through mental health challenges, whether you had been admitted or whatever. There's changes to your health. Your body is doing something that is harming you in some way. And that's hard to come to terms with. And then I think also it's, a two-pronged approach. I think it's doctors checking in on the whole patient, not just the medical side of them. That's one thing my oncologist did a great job of, was asking how I was doing, not just how I was feeling about, like, from the side effects of chemo and everything, but how I was doing. And he wouldn't, he really read into my body language or my nonverbals on how I was feeling. There's a lot of different programs out there, like Immerman's Angels, or there's all sorts of different ones that pair you up with somebody who's been there. And having somebody who just checks in on you to make sure you are doing your best. And if you're not doing your best, what they can do to help support you. And, the great thing about social media is there's support groups for practically everything out there. You got to find them and use them for what they are. But I think just really having open conversation about, you are going to go through things. I know statistics say something like, 70-80% of people with cancer go through some sort of mental health. I would say that's 100%. That's 70-80% of people who are reporting it or admitting it or whatever, but there's going to be, cancer is a scary thing. It doesn't have to be as scary as, it used to be a couple decades ago, or even as recently as a decade ago. But just understanding and recognizing that there is going to be mental health ramifications, and that's normal. And you're not wrong, or you're not weak for thinking that. It's, you are being strong by admitting that there's something wrong, and you're being strong by getting help and not just saying, I'm just going to grin and bear it. You're doing what you can to take care of yourself. And if you think about it, any chronic illness, you'll be in and out of doctors for months, if not years, to take care of a problem. Mm-hmm. Taking care of mental health is no different. You need to take care of your mental health. We're not just our bodies, we're our mind as well. And if you're not taking care of your mind just as well as taking care of your body, you're missing at least half the equation, if not more.
Exactly. And both, I like to use the word like holistic approach, and not HOL, but WHOLE. taking a holistic approach where medical providers are taking that approach. As you said, your oncologist had continued to encourage you and kind of saw some of the signs of the emotional impact this process of, you know, basically fighting through cancer and could see that effect on you. And I feel it's just so important that the medical field, but also ourselves and patient communities and advocates, that we are speaking about this concept of holistic approach and that we need to look at the person as a whole and provide those supports or access those supports to, you know, help all the different things that comes along with having cancer, chronic illness. You know, and the other thing is too, is that in situations such as yourself, you know, I had a brother that was diagnosed with leukemia. He was 5 and I was 8. And so to kind of go through that process as a child and a sibling and then grow up to be kind of a bit of a caretaker at some point, and then literally becoming an advocate where I'd be going into the hospital where my brother was hospitalized and the doctors not knowing who my brother was, and then having to advocate, you know, on his behalf so that we can get, you know, these providers on the same page, but also really advocate with my brother about, hey, you know, like it's a two-way street. We gotta meet part of the way. So when it comes to cancer and chronic illnesses and these chronic conditions, the other important piece is that while we are encouraging the patient to access mental health care and emotional support systems, it's also important that all those people, you know, who are closely connected to that individual be open to accessing mental health services or support groups, because I know looking back as a child, how we interpret things and then how we can process them as an adult are two different things. They really had to think, you know, having these conversations, it was such a normal circumstance. And then to realize like, no, my circumstances growing up were not normal. And how did that shape me as a person? Obviously good things. Not always every little piece was good though, because, you know, I noticed I like would have a little bit of kind of like anger underneath. And it comes out in certain ways where when I see healthcare systems failing children, or when I'm seeing these inequities in healthcare, because my brother being male, especially as he became a young adult, just the difference of, I guess, perception in medical care facilities on their approach with him and not looking into his history and understanding this is a young man who has been ill since 5 years of age. And here he is at, you know, 18, still ill. Here he is at, you know, 20 and whatnot, what have you. And again, that's a holistic approach. So, you know, I really had to kind of sit down in a space with myself and process all those, like I said, inequities and processing like that. My situation wasn't normal. And having those conversations so that people understand they're not alone, that other people have gone through similar paralleling situations. So yeah, and that's the other thing too, is that friends, family, significant others, spouses, even your community, a neighbor, depending on how close you are, that we need to encourage the support system supporting the individual with cancer and chronic illness or to also access those supports that are out there so that we're all kind of on the same page going through the process and addressing our emotional well-being with everything that comes along. So with that said, as the patient community and advocacy community, what are some ways, we've talked about some ways to break down like societal stigmas and barriers. What are some other ways that these communities and health-centric driven organizations, what they can do to support and motivate men with that obtaining early medical mental health care?
Yeah, I think it's a two-phase approach. Like I said, I'm not going to harp on it, but just talking about your experience and raising up other men who have talked about their experience, I think, you know, a little conversation can go a long way. But then I think bigger is making it more accessible. My I see a therapist through telehealth, so it's great. I don't have to travel anywhere. I do it from my phone or my computer, and I think getting more male providers who really understand male issues and can weigh in on different things, I think that's huge. But I think that's really what it comes down to, is just conversation and access, making it, you know, finding the different pain points and removing those pain points, so there are less and less excuses on to why you can't take care of your mental health.
100%. And also, one little, an idea of mine is I also feel, obviously I advocate in the space for veterans and fibromyalgia and chronic pain, but I feel like as patients and advocates and patient driven organizations and health centric organizations, that we really need to open up our platforms where and invite, you know, fellow patients and advocates on to share their story, even though it's not within the space. Because one of the things that I know from my experience as a veteran and living with fibromyalgia and chronic pain is that we see a lot of coexisting medical conditions and mental health conditions on top of the original condition that kind of was the catalyst for it all. And so while I won't know what it's like to have testicular cancer, I do on all my platforms have men that follow me. And having these open discussions, we might be able to connect with someone that I don't even realize is, you know, contending with cancer, testicular cancer, or if I've had men on to talk about lupus or Gulf War illness and other cancers and heart conditions, that opening our platforms is also supportive of both communities. So I also feel that having these open dialogues and honesty and not being shy or abashed to tackle these barriers that continue to be pervasive and interfering with men, but even, you know, patients as a whole, is accessing healthcare, that if we're discussing and sharing our story and, you know, why it's important, you know, like when in doubt, get checked out, that hopefully it will connect with someone in my community. And then, you know, if someone has me in their platform, there's going to be someone in their community that might be a veteran or have fibro and connect. So we're all interconnected in one way or another. I like to look at it as like a spider web, like each person's the center and everything branches out from there, or 7 degrees of separation. You know, separation or the Kevin Bacon rule, but somehow we know someone who knows someone who knows someone. And so I feel it's important that we don't just stay in our lane of advocacy, but opening up our platforms so that everybody can share their story, because our story or our book of life can end up becoming someone's survival guide.
Yeah, I agree 100% with everything you just said there.
Well, this is why we're friends.
Exactly.
Is there any other tips or advice you would like to share before we finish out this discussion?
No, I think, you know, just as I said, take care of your mental health, physical and mental and physical health, and just talk about it with your friends. There's the dog. I think just conversation goes a long way.
So we start having that discussion and support and paving ways for men to have more access to platforms and healthcare services and emotional and mental health supports, so that they can be supported in a holistic way.
Exactly.
On their healthcare journey.
The W.
Yes, with the W for winning, because you're getting your healthcare done and preventative care and all that fun stuff. So Justin, thank you so much for joining me today. And if you found this interview and discussion balls to the walls, make sure you like and share. Check out Justin on his website at A Ballsy Sense of Tumor for some great information, support, and a few laughs. And until next time, make your self-care your number one priority. Love yourselves and love each other.
You gotta get bruised before you get mad. You gotta fall down before you fight back. Was feeling so weak, but baby, I'm strong. Little did I know I'm a champion. I'm a champion. I'm a champion.
never change? Why do I crumble quickly, stumble swiftly? Cursing the world, I burn the songs I wrote a billion times in my head. I'm feeling low, got nowhere to go but back up again.
You gotta get bruised before you get mad. You gotta fall down before you fight back. Was feeling so weak, but baby I'm strong. Little did I know I'm a champion. I'm a champion.